Chapter number 5. We'll be reading verses 12 through 21. I'll read the even verses and you'll read the odd verses with me. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 12 through 21. I'll read the even, you'll read the odd. The Bible says, "For we commend not ourselves again unto you, but give you occasion to glory in our behalf, that ye may have somewhat to answer them which glory in appearance and not in heart. For whether we be beside ourselves, it is to God, or whether we be sober, it is for your cause. For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge, that if one died for all, then were all dead. And that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Wherefore henceforth know we no man after the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now when we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin no more, for no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." Let's pray. Father, thank you for this day in which we have prayed for so many months. And this is a day which, Lord, we get to see just how much we get to be behind this project and how far we can go this year. We pray that you would bless every family, every adult, every teenager, every child that has an offering with them. I pray, dear God, that this love offering with sacrifice from our hearts would be used by you to see great things happen for our building this year. Now be with our pastor as he preaches to us. Give us exactly what we need this morning. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
I dreamt I went to heaven. You were there with me. Walked upon the streets of gold beside the crystal sea. We heard the angels singing. Then someone called your name. We turned and saw a young man. He was smiling as he came. And he said, "Friend, you may not know me now." Then he said, "But wait, you used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. And every day you would say a prayer before the class would start. And that one day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave." Then another man stood before you. He said, "Remember the time a missionary came to this church. His pictures made you cry. He didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Jesus took the gift you gave. That's why I'm here today. Giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad that you gave. Then another man stood before you. He said, remember the time a missionary came to this church. His pictures made you cry. Didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Jesus took the gift you gave. That's why I'm here today. I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry, but I am almost sure there are tears in your eyes. Then Jesus took your hand. You stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. I am so glad you gave.
Thank you for that. Of course, this morning and today is our offering for our building. If you are visiting with us this morning, thank you for being here. And we're going to talk about giving to the building. And if you're visiting, that's not for you. You just happen to come on a day when we're visiting. Unless for some reason you're independently wealthy. And then in that case, whatever God leads, you chuck, okay? But you're here and we'll start getting back to normal subjects next week. But this is an important time, and this is an important subject, and so we need to hit it. I will not be long this morning, because when I'm done, our invitation will be receiving an offering, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. The last few weeks, I've been talking a little bit about giving and the importance of it. Mother's Day last week, we even talked about it. And some people are like, that's a great Mother's Day message. We didn't talk about mothers, but you're still wonderful. But we've been talking about our theme, standing together. All of us doing what we can together to get the building done. And to be honest with you, excuse me, it's going to take all of us. Yeah. Now, we can't all be involved to the same extent, but we all can be involved somehow. If this is your church, and you'll want to be a part of that. And so that's very, very important. Now, getting into the message, God has given each of us different personalities. Have you ever noticed that? How many of you have more than one child? Okay? Your children are all different, right? You get one child, it's like, this one is just really smart. God's gifted them. They're kind of got this really calm personality, and wow, children aren't that bad. And then you have another one, and their personality is not calm, and they are, and maybe they struggle a bit more. They all have different, God's given us that. God has given some outward social. They're extroverts. I mean, they're just like, they come in and they're the life of the party. After a half an hour, everybody knows them. Brother Esposito, Johnny Esposito, is an extrovert. How many of you caught on to that? Pastor Esposito was not as much an extrovert. Him and Pastor and Johnny went to Bible college 2 years before I did. And within a week, everybody knew Brother Johnny. Okay? It took 2 years before everybody knew Pastor Esposito. Johnny was just, we're just different. Some people are private, shy, introverts. That's no bad. That's just the way God makes each of us. But because we have different motivational personalities, doesn't mean that we cannot be driven to do that which is right. Amen. Sometimes we look at somebody and like, it's just easier for them to go out and do something because of their personality. You know, you can be driven whether you have an extrovert personality or your personality is more introverted. We think of someone who is driven. We think of someone who's an extrovert, very active, usually very loud, a doer. But that doesn't necessarily mean that someone that is not like that is not driven. Being driven is not a matter of personality. Here's the key. It's a matter of motivation. Motivation. You can be motivated no matter what you are, no matter what your personality. Look, you ever work, we work, and I know you have, you ever work somewhere where there's someone who you could categorize as lazy? If you have a union job, they'll usually get away with it. I worked at a warehouse. It was a union job. And there was one guy, I joke around sometimes, say, man, if they walked any slower, they'd be going in reverse. And this guy was one of those kind of guys. But I kid you not, when we all got done with work and we'd clean up and we'd start lining up at the clock to check out, he was always first in line. And he was always the first to his car and the first out of the parking lot. It wasn't the fact that he was lazy. He was just not motivated. But when he got motivated by going home, he hustled. Motivation is very important. In our text that Brother Chim read for us, proper motivation for ministry is given. Paul, on many occasions, was criticized by those who were not Christians, or the Jews who were getting on Christianity, as being someone that would do the things that he would do for personal gain, for self-gratification. And Paul was not like that at all. Paul served the Lord because he loved the Lord. You see, Paul here is explaining proper motivation for ministry. We do understand that what we believe determines how we behave. Doctrine, which is what we believe, is always connected to duty, how we believe. And that is also true of motivation. In other words, we should be motivated properly because of the doctrine or the teachings of the Word of God. If we're going to live right, it's because we're motivated because we see in the Bible that God wants us to live a certain way or act a certain way. Now, what I want us to focus on this morning, the few minutes I have, is that little phrase in verse 14, "For the love of Christ constraineth us." The word constraineth means like to push together so you can compel forward. You know what we call that? Being driven. Being driven. For the love of Christ constrains us. It drives us to do everything that we're supposed to do that is right. I think every Christian should be driven. See, the problem with most Christians and the ones that do not live the Christian life correctly or just kind of half in or half out, you're not driven. And you say, you say this all the time, then I'm not going to change. We're not driven because we're not in the Word of God. Because when we're in the Word of God and we're knowing the Word of God and we're believing it, it's going to drive us to do the right kind of things. And by the way, don't take the word driven like someone beating you down, okay? I'm not talking about that. There are some churches, you know, they want you at church every day of the week. And, you know, if you're not doing 100 different things, listen, I want you to be faithful to all the services, share your faith, find your place in the church. But that doesn't mean you're here 7 days a week. No, I am, because I work here, okay? But you should be driven to do. Some people need to constantly be motivated. But you know what? And that's true of all of us in a sense, I guess. But you know, if we are in the Word of God and we're walking with God, we will be driven in a good way to do the things that God wants us to do. The love of Christ constraineth us to push us forward. Driven. Today, I want to apply what I'm going to apply to our building, because these things, the building is not about a building. The building is about the ministry. The building is about ministry. What I mean by ministry is serving the Lord and reaching others with the gospel. That's what the building is about. It's not about being some kind of big shot. If you've been to our church any amount of time, we're not into big shot. Okay? You're not going to go to raypachardo.com. The ministry of the Filipino tornado. No, we're not doing that. Okay? CharlieChim.org. It's not about that, you know. We're not going to put a CD out where it's like, you know, Steve Myers sings about God. No, okay? That kind of stuff is nonsense. That's not who we are. You know what we are? We're just a church of people that love God, want to help others. That's all it is. Nobody's a big shot. And so we need to be driven. Paul gives us six motivations. I call this driven to given. There's six motivations here that drive me to give. Let me give them to you very brief. You say, I thought you said it's going to be short. It'll be short points. First of all, I'm driven by the love of God. For the love of Christ constraineth us. Now, I'll give you other reasons, but if I stop right here, that's all we need. I am constrained when I understand how much God loves me. Now, it's important that we do things because we love God, right? Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. But can I just tell you something? That's not what he said. The love of Christ constrains us. It's his love for us. Hey, I want you to love God. And I want you to do what you do because you love God. But we can set that aside because the more important thing is that he loves us. If you really understand who, you know, so, well, you know, sometimes we want these celebrities. And I, to be honest with you, I don't really buy much into Christian celebrities because they usually do things that reproach Christ. You know, if this movie actor got saved, it'd be great. If that movie actor got saved, he'd act like an idiot, and he would make Christ look bad. Okay, by the way, everybody tries to make this guy Bono from U2 a Christian. He's a pagan. That's in Christian circles, Brother Pichardo. Their lyrics are moral. Listen, the guy just said came out for abortion. He's for partying. We try to do that. We think if this person, oh, that's going to motivate everybody. No. You know what motivates us? Not that we love him, although that should motivate us. He loves us. That is a big deal. Do you know who you are in God's eyes? You're dirt. Me too. You say, what happens when it rains? We're wet. We're mud. Okay? We're nothing. And he still loved us. The only worth you have, and you have worth, don't get me wrong, but it's not because of anything that you have. It's because of his love for you. It's because of his love for us that makes us anything, that makes us valuable. Amen. His love for us. 1 John 4:10, herein is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. 1 John 4:19, we love him. That's a big deal. No, the second part is because he loved us. He first loved us. So you know why I'm motivated? I'm giving sacrificially, and not just today, although we are giving sacrificially today. Praise the Lord. We gave a number we're going to give, and the Lord's blessed us, and we've been hoarding, and we've been able to give almost double that. But I'm not doing it for you, although I kind of like you. I'm not doing it just for the church, although I love the church. I'm doing it because God loves me. And I'm driven by his love to give to him. Number two, we're driven by a Christ-purposed life. Verse 15, and that he died for all, that they which live, here we go, should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him. There's a contrast here that gives us all the motivation that we need to live for him. He died for me so I could live for him. That's it. What did Paul say? For me to live is to die is gain. Paul said, listen, the best thing would be to go to heaven. If you understand the Bible, you understand the end times, you understand the afterlife, heaven's a good place. We're not going to float around on clouds with harps. That's boring. I like harp music, but listen, I'm not playing, okay? No, heaven's a wonderful place. There'll be lots to do for all eternity. It'll be so much better than anything this earth could ever offer. But Paul said, I'm not in heaven. I haven't died. So you know what? Why I'm here? To live is Christ. So I'm driven by a Christ-purpose life. When I live for Jesus, that answers a lot of questions in my life. What kind of things should I do? How shall I spend my time? What is really important? What is really valuable in this life? And what should be my purpose for living? All of those questions are answered when we live for Christ. Do you really love Jesus? Do you really seek to live for him? By the way, don't be discouraged if you struggle sometimes. Don't, you know, the devil is so good at sometimes we try to live for Christ and we have a little detour, we do something wrong. It's like, see, quit. No, don't quit. Keep going forward. Don't get discouraged. He wants us to live for him. And there's always a better day if we're willing to work for it. So we're driven by a Christ purpose life. Because I desire to live a life, a Christ-driven life, I have no problem giving. In fact, I'm driven to giving. Number three, I'm driven by a completely changed future. Verse 17, we know this well. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new what? Creature. That describes us pretty well, huh? He didn't say a new person, although there's other places in the Bible. We're a creature. We're a new creature. Old things are passed away. Passed away means dead, done. Now, when someone dies, we say they passed away. I like the Bible word. The Bible word is Jesus used is they're asleep. See, when you're asleep, you're not gone forever. When you're sleeping, you wake up. That's temporary. When we're dead, we're sleeping. That's temporary because we have eternal home in heaven. One day we'll have a resurrected brand new body. And so that's just a temporary thing. But the old man that he wants us, we're a new creature. That old guy, he passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Man, you know, when Jesus Christ saves us and becomes a part of us, every aspect of our life can be different. Thank God for that. Now, sometimes we struggle with that. But you understand that, listen, before I was saved, I was living a different life. Zero. But now when I'm saved, I've been born again, I'm a brand new creature, now I can be changed. Sometimes a couple will come in and then they get saved. They get saved after they're married and their marriage struggled. Hey, listen. Now your marriage is never going to be perfect, so don't back up there. But your marriage can be different because you're different. Your relationships in your lives can be different because you're different. Amen. The life you used to live, the direction you used to take, that can all be different because you're different. Yes, and by the way, we can share that with others. And when someone comes and meets Christ, they have the opportunity to have a completely different life. Thank God for that. I'm in on that. Our church is in on that. And that is what we are all about. A completely changed future. If I was driven by the old life, I wouldn't give a penny to this building. Because if I'm driven by the old life, I just want what's on this earth. But you know what I understand? There's a better day coming. And there's more to life than just hoarding money. There's more to life. Now, I'm not against you taking care of your bills and putting away some for the future and getting the things you need. Don't get me wrong. But I'm saying because of this, I'm driven to take that which I could keep for myself and give it to something that is of more eternal value. Yes, sir. You know the little fallacy? He who dies with the most toys wins. He who dies with the most whatever loses. Oh, you know who wins? Your wife's new husband. He wins. He's driving your car. He has access to your bank account. Now, he does have one bad thing. He gets your wife. Now, I'm kidding. I am kidding. That's why everyone should have a life insurance. Not too much, okay? That's a temptation. So I'm driven to give by Christ because of Christ's giving power. Number four, I'm driven by a divinely restored relationship. Look at verse 18. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Christ Jesus. Before I met Christ on Easter Sunday, 1980, my relationship with God was zero. Here was my relationship with God. He was the creator and I was his creation. And that was it. I did not have a living, vital relationship with him because my spirit was dead in sin. And something happened on Easter Sunday, 1978. I put 80, I meant 1978. I got saved. Now my spirit was born again. And now not only was my eternal destiny flipped, now he was my father and I'm his son. Now I have a relationship with God. Now I can actually draw close to the Lord. That's what really reconciliation is. Reconciled means a relationship that has been changed thoroughly. Thoroughly. You ever see two people, sometimes there's a couples and they'll split up for a while and maybe God works in their life and they work it out, they get back together and we say, they've reconciled. You know, we were split from God because of our sin, but he sent Jesus Christ to die for our sin so it can be forgiven. And guess what? That close relationship with him now is reconciled. Sometimes siblings, sometimes friends, they have a conflict and they kind of get away from each other. But once the conflict is dealt with, they can now reconcile. I am reconciled to God. I can have a relationship. You know, I would hate to have to live this life without being able to have a relationship with God. To go through this life on your own. To try to get through all the messes that happens. And the younger you are, the harder it is sometimes for you to get that. But as you get older and things of life start to happen and friends and people die and all those things that happen with just aging and you realize, man, if I didn't have the Lord to lean on, well, you know, you Christians are weak. God's your crutch. I'm in. In fact, he's not my crutch on one side. I'm a crutch on both sides, okay? It's like both legs are broken. So you're weak. You need a crutch. No, I'm strong. I know I need a crutch. And my strength is not because of me. It's because of him. We need God. And because I can have a divinely restored relationship, that drives me to give. And I want others to partake in that too. Number five, I'm driven by a graciously given responsibility. Verse 18, the last part of the verse, not only has he reconciled us, and verse 18 says, and hath given us the ministry of reconciliation. Verse 19, to wit that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses into them. One of the reasons we're reconciled is because we trust Christ. He takes all of our trespasses and sin, and he wipes them clean. And hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. What does that mean? We're reconciled to God, and once we're reconciled, God says, you're commissioned, get out there, and help others to become reconciled to me. That's the ministry of reconciliation. That's what we do. That's the work we do. We talk about the ministry of the church. Listen, this is the ministry of the church. Let's help others to get reconciled to God. Say, well, what do you think you have some special relationship that others don't have? If I'm saved and they're not? Yes. But it's a relationship they can have. But they'll never have that relationship, that ministry of reconciliation, unless we step to the second part, which is the word of reconciliation. Someone's got to tell them. Last Sunday night in church, we talked about that. Philip, revival in Samaria, people getting saved, and God says, I want you to go talk to one man, an Ethiopian eunuch that worked for the queen, who was seeking God, who was sitting in a chariot reading the best scripture in the Old Testament to find Jesus, and he had no clue. And God said, Philip, you go down there, you got to explain it to him. And Philip went down there and talked to that one man, and he received Christ. God's given us. And by the way, that's graciously given. The fact that God would allow us to speak on his behalf is truly remarkable. And so, why am I driven to giving? That's our responsibility, people. It's not just us four and no more. It's not just, let's just be content with what we have going on here. Listen, if we have something going on here that's good, why on earth would we not want to share that with others? I am so thankful that someone shared it with me. I am so thankful when I walked into Gethsemane Baptist Temple after I was saved, had no clue what I was doing, there was people there that wanted to encourage me to do the right thing. Thankful for that. And I'm thankful we have a church like that here. Very important. I'm driven to giving by the fact that we personally and as a church have a responsibility to help others reconcile with God. And then lastly, and I'm done, we're driven by a royally appointed position. A royally appointed position. Verse 20. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you, in Christ said, be reconciled. We are ambassadors. An ambassador lives in a foreign land representing the leadership of his land. Do you know you're an ambassador for King Jesus? You know, this world is not our home. The song says, I'm just a passing through. Now, we have a hard time understanding that because we're building some pretty deep roots sometimes. But, you know, we live here and I understand it and I get it. But really, if we think about it, this world isn't our home. And while we're on this earth, we don't just represent ourselves, our own desires, our own whatever we want. We represent the King of Heaven. That's a wonderful thing. I represent King Jesus. You know, it's kind of like kids are like, my dad can beat your dad up, okay? You know, my dad can do more jail time than your dad or whatever it is because my dad's a Raider fan, you know, okay? No. Listen, my king is greater than any king on this world, in this world, because he's King Jesus. And to think that he has appointed me to represent him is an awesome blessing, and it's also an awesome responsibility. And I want to make sure that I represent him well. Let me say this and I'm done. If I'm going to represent him well, I need to understand that I represent the land of eternity. Heaven. That is my real home. That, if you are saved, is your real home. And we have been called on this earth not to get so caught up in everything. And I know there's things we have to take care of on this earth. I understand that. But let's not get so caught up in what's going on in this earth that it causes us to lose our connection with our real home. And let's understand that as we live our life, though we're not perfect, we should represent our gracious King who reconciled us to himself. And I could give many more reasons, but this is what's in this scriptures. But I give for a reason. I am driven to give because of what Christ has done for me. That's my motivation. I know we say, I want to do something for God, and some of us are driven by that. But the reason we want to do something for God isn't so we can just say we did something for God. It's because he's done something for us, and we represent him. If we could bow our heads and close our eyes just for a minute.